I've known Price Headley for a lot of years. He's definitely he's a great guy, very knowledgeable about the markets. I've had the pleasure of attending a lot of Price's presentations at different Metastock users conferences around the world. He's joined us in Vegas. He's joined us in Australia. He's done many a webinar to our group. And his add-on here at Metastock has been one of the top add-ons, top sellers over time. So definitely people grasp his concepts because they are very concise, very clear, and very understandable. So I think you're really going to enjoy Price's presentation today. So with that, let's go ahead and get Price on the line here and have him start his presentation. Price, I'll go ahead and turn it over to you.
Well, thanks so much, Kelly, and welcome everybody. Glad to be with you today. And you got a power-packed lineup here, so really a lot of fun to be with so many other great educators here. So let me go ahead and share my PowerPoint. We're going to roll through quite a bit of content here over the next hour, or just under an hour here. The topic is how to spot accelerations in stocks and options. You know, and really my whole principle when I founded Big Trends back in '99 was focused on accelerating stocks give me the best option trade. So a lot of what we'll talk about today is how do you take advantage of finding those stocks, and then really a simple strategy to use to then trade options on them. Just a quick disclaimer, of course, access to Big Trends and its coaching services and these kind of educational events is provided for your education and information only. Nothing that I talk about today should be considered a specific recommendation of buy or sell any particular investment. And ultimately, you know that you are solely responsible for your investment decisions. So Big Trends and its staff, of course, are not responsible for any trades you choose to make or trades you choose not to make. Not all Big Trends products.
The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Yeah, hi everybody. Price Headley, glad to be with you. Just doing a quick overview of our disclaimer, just a reminder that, of course, you're solely responsible for any decisions you choose to make. And know that we're not making any particular recommendation today. I'm going to be sharing with you how to spot big trends through accelerating situations. And just remember that you need to consult with your tax and financial advisor before you make any investment that might impact your unique financial and tax situation. Now, you know, the Big Trends Toolkit is something that we put together a number of years ago, but it continues to be one of the more popular platform or toolkit add-ons that you can add on to your Metastock software. And I think part of the reason is because we give you a lot. It's not just one technique. These are techniques I've developed over time that have an edge. And so some of them are tweaks on existing indicators. This BTTK stands for Big Trends Toolkit. And we're going to talk about just a few of them here today, my acceleration bands. I know John Bollinger just shared with you some techniques with Bollinger bands. We'll actually talk about some things you can do with acceleration bands and Bollinger bands together to find big trends and accelerations in stocks and the market. We'll also talk today about the efficiency ratio. This is a little tweak I did to a talk I saw Perry Kaufman, who's an excellent analyst and actually a former NASA rocket scientist, talking about the concept of price efficiency, and I created this indicator around it called the efficiency ratio based on Kaufman's comments. And we'll also be talking about Larry Williams' indicator, the percent R indicator, known as the percent range. So talking about a few of these pieces of the puzzle, there's a lot more that goes into the toolkit, but I want to give you kind of a groundwork today. We're really focused on how you can zero in on these type of opportunities here. Now, let's start with acceleration. I promise you to talk about accelerations. We'll start with the indicator I developed called acceleration bands. You know, and the idea here is that we're all looking, when we do a trade, we would like speed to be in our favor. We want to be on the right side of which way the trend is speeding up and heating up. We don't want to be on any slow boats when it comes to options trading in particular. But even for stocks, or if you trade futures, Forex, ETFs, you can apply these principles to anything that you're trading. Now, like a lot of you, I started trading with moving averages, but I had a couple problems with moving averages. I still use a moving average as an overview, but frankly, if you're trading on moving average crossovers, breakouts of a moving average, you're going to get a ton of signals. What I am more interested in first is high quality signals. Then the quantity can take care of itself over time. So from this perspective, when you're talking about this kind of a setup here, you want to get into fewer but higher quality trades at first and really build your confidence that you're trading the best of the best situations. I am never going to be one who tries to buy below the market. In fact, I once heard John Bollinger at a conference talk about that one of his mentors said you're allowed to buy the exact low and the exact high tick once in your lifetime. And I got a kick out of that because it's so true. You know, our ego wants to pick exact bottoms and tops, but that's not how to maximize your profitability in the markets. You will get whipsawed a lot. You will cost yourself buying into downtrends too much or selling uptrends too soon. And you don't want to do that. You want to get yourself in tune with the sweet spot. Where's the right best of the best time to trade? And we're talking about options trading and options buying in particular. You can certainly tie it into spread trades and options too, but I want to focus you on just a simple option buying strategy today. But first, I want to get the right stocks, because a lot of the best stocks, when I was getting started trading in 1990, fresh out of graduating from Duke University, thought I was ready to be the next master of the universe. Right, we all kind of have that initial feeling after a winning trade or two of thinking this is easy, right? And then you get your knocks if you get into that mode of, especially I was coming into it with a very perfectionist mentality of used to studying hard, doing well, and thinking the harder I worked, the luckier I got, right? Well, you know, sometimes in the markets, if you're on the wrong side of the trend, as you know, you can't just keep plowing in or digging your heels in. You've got to be flexible. So the best stocks, the ones in that day, were Microsoft, Amgen, Home Depot, the like, that were really the growth stocks of that era, were not coming back. They didn't come back to give you that test of the major moving averages. So if you're sitting there waiting to get on the next Apple, the next Tesla, when they're in that growth phase, you're going to miss out on that phase. And by the time you get them back down at the moving average, the growth phase is already done, at least for a while. So I like the idea of adaptive bands, like John Bollinger's Bollinger Bands, like the Chaikin bands, I looked at Bomar bands, I looked at moving average envelopes, I looked at Keltner channels, a whole lot of different things. And then I stumbled across sort of this combination of things that factor in the volatility, like a Bollinger Band and other ones, but also factors in the trend. And it's going to be maybe a little slower to adapt. The acceleration bands, like a two-deviation Bollinger Band, should encompass about 95% of the action. And we've got a lot to share, so we're going to kind of keep it moving here. So a prior metastock grab of Apple, you can see that Apple did a real nice job outside of these acceleration bands in blue. And these are plotted around that middle line. It's just a 20-day simple moving average. Okay, so, you know, that's a 20 SMA. Simple moving average, of course, is just the average of the closes of the last 20 bars. That's about a month on the daily chart. So what I look for is not one close outside of those bands, which you see does not count in my work, but actually it's got to be two closes in a row outside of those bands. So you can see entries happening here when we're moving outside of there, and then you can see it's not just a move back into the acceleration band that gives me an exit. I use a trailing faster exponential moving average for the exit. So when it violates that, then you hop out. But we're trying to catch this parabolic kind of effect here for that period of, it could last for a couple days, could last for a week, sometimes could last for multiple weeks, like you saw the surge on the second close here that July for Apple, lasting for several weeks into that phase. Now, obviously, if you're an option trader, you need some basic rules on how you can manage the leverage of options in your favor and still keep riding. Now, not every one of those trades is going to work. You can see on that chart, there's about three that work pretty nicely to give you that first burst to be able to catch, hopefully, the quick pop. Typically, we would say if you get a double on an option, you want to take half of it out, no questions asked. If you take half of it out, we'll talk about that on a future slide, you basically get your risk capital back. Then you try to ride the rest. If it doesn't work, you stop out the rest and you move on. You can see then there's a couple of these where you get the second close above, and that one's wrong right there back on the left side of the page, and you see about a week and a half later it's knocking you out of that trade at the trailing stop. So in that case, you're going to lose. And the nature of options is that, yes, you will have losing trades, but our goal is to minimize those. Know that if we're wrong, we want to hop out of those real quickly. If we're right, we want to sell part of it at a first profit target and then keep riding for the bigger acceleration home run opportunity. Most of the time, though, you'll see it'll say stuck in the middle of these bands here from the low to the high, or one close outside doesn't count, one close below doesn't count, and then you'll save yourself a lot of potential whipsaws. Let's look at a more zoomed-in example on a couple of these. And part of what we also now do is we also factor in like a longer-term moving average, where, of course, if Apple's been trending up, we're not going to take that sell signal if it's trending above a long-term average. We want to line up our short-term signals with the direction of a longer-term trend. The more you align the multiple time frames, folks, the more you'll be finding your trading's a lot easier. It's like you're flowing with multiple rivers of time all flowing in your favor. So here's one where you get one and then two closes outside of that upper band. Now here's where we put in the trailing exponential moving average, and you can actually see it visually in purple there, where this keeps on holding even though it came back into the bands there soon after the breakout. It was kind of choppy those first few days. Then it went parabolic. See, your goal is not to get on a linear trend, one of those that's kind of steadily going up. A lot of people draw trend channels. I would much rather be on the one that breaks outside of there and goes parabolic. The rocket ships is where you can make money faster. And, of course, with options, you can, of course, then compound your money better that way while still having a way out of the trade if it's not working. See, it came close to breaking the trailing moving average right there. It didn't quite happen, and then it violated a little bit more sharply by the time it closed below that moving average. See, most of the indicators you'll see me focus on here, once I'm in the trade, I tend to focus on the close of each candle or the close of each bar, so that the idea is that you're not whipsawing yourself out by a potential fake out. We want to stay with the true trends and avoid those little whipsaw fake outs, but when it does close below a key trailing stop or a key trailing inflection point that I'll share with you on percent R, for example, then you've got to say bye-bye to the trade. So you can see, you know, for example, in this one on the next buy, that one's wrong. And so what we tend to encourage is that the acceleration band can be the first launch point. You're going to see me add these other filters to say, you know what, if it doesn't hold that level, we'll probably add part of our capital in the breakout and then part on what I call the retest. So I'll share with you how retests work here as well. Now, this closing stop concept, the intraday noise, I think, is most traders' enemy, or intra-bar noise. If you're a short-term swing trader, you could do the same principle with an hourly chart. We'll talk about the key time frames for each type of trader here a little bit later. But bottom line is that, you know, I like to put my stops at the end of a given bar, which means that essentially we're not putting them in to be whipsawed by that intra-bar movement. So we say, okay, you know what your key level is. You know if that gets broken, then you blow the trade out. Okay, so there's no questions asked about where a trade gets out. What I love about the MetaStock software, of course, is it shows you very clear buy arrows and sell arrows based on all the indicators that we've coded the Big Trends way for our Big Trends toolkit plugin. So the closing stop idea saved me a lot of whipsaws. Sure, every once in a while, it's going to kind of move through your trailing stop, your trailing moving average, your trailing key retest point a little bit more than you want. And so you've got to prepare for that by saying, let's not overcommit our capital in any one trade. I would rather see you trade smaller at first and get comfortable with the methodology and then build yourself up over time to a more full position. You should always focus on learning whatever methodology you're trading on a small scale. You could even start with it on a paper trade. Of course, we all know paper trade is not the same as trading real money. But you can start paper trade, you can then go small trades to get comfortable with how that works and how that feels and make sure it fits for you, and then ultimately you can then move up to your normal position size. But you never want to overcommit your capital. That's how a lot of even the best and brightest on Wall Street have blown themselves up. So for a daily chart, and I'm waiting for the end of the day, I tell people if it's violated that key level within 15 minutes or less before the end of the day, you can get out. You could get out either at the limit, a limit order at the bid, or you could just place a market order to exit the position. Even for those of you that are working a day job, if it violates and you don't see it by the close, you can get out the next bar's open. Sure, sometimes it might gap in your favor or might gap against you a little bit the next bar. Those things tend to wash out over time. But once the signal is done, you've got no business being in that trade. We're in such a bull market environment now, but I think it's refreshing to also remind ourselves that this can work on both sides. You know, it can work on the upside and it can work on the downside. When Fannie Mae, FNM at the time, you're not going to find some of these symbols anymore because some of them have gone bye-bye. But bottom line is that you'll see, like sometimes you might get an entry on the downside below the lower boundary of the lower acceleration band, now in green. You can always customize the colors to whatever works for you. See, it slightly violated as it got a little too steep on that bounce, even though that was what we'll call a retest in the percent R terminology. See, the next one it caught, even the bounce back into the bands did not catch the trailing stop. It stayed with it through this phase here until it broke out back here. So as it's moving down from about 52 down to about 27, about a 50% haircut, that's what we call a waterfall decline. You know, obviously as a trader, if you're buying options, you love the prospect of catching waterfall declines, right? They don't always happen, but with downside moves, they can happen very quickly, and you've got to be positioned to take advantage of it. Now, you see, then the next one, after catching a 50% haircut, this next one that breaks down here, it starts to move in your favor. Then it knocks you out with a pretty violent move back through there on a close. So that one was not so pretty, right? And so that's why we'd say, okay, look, not all of these are going to work. But the point is that you're setting yourself up for that possibility. When you add the other filters, it's about winning big and still containing your losses. That's really the nature of the whole big trends methodology. And what I love about this method is that, yeah, this one you lose small. You get knocked out for a little loss on that next one there in June. And then look at what happens. The next one, if you gave up on it because you'd had a couple of quick whipsaws, you would have missed the next move when Fannie went from 20 down to next to nothing. I didn't run it all the way through September, but it basically got crushed down. The equity shareholders got just absolutely demolished as that thing ultimately went out belly up for common stockholders. Now, John Bollinger talked with you just in the prior session about his Bollinger Bands, and you know, I would typically look at comparing an acceleration band and a Bollinger Band together. If you want to look at them on the same plot, you can actually say a 20-day Bollinger Band with two deviations using that same 20-day simple moving average, and so you've got that same midpoint for both of these bands, but we're using the same factor too to try to cover on the acceleration bands about the same roughly 95% of the action. Why would we be interested then in trading the other 5% of the action? Because that's what's not expected. And the two different bands here have different ways of reacting to a breakout. So it's going to be interesting when you see that. The rules here is that look for two closes in a row outside of the acceleration band, and the Bollinger Band needs to be outside of the acceleration band. Okay, so what will happen is the Bollinger Band will race to catch up to a breakout faster than the acceleration band. And so we want to take advantage of that view, what happens. And then what we'd say is that reset your stop on if it closes. Once the cross of the Bollinger back inside the acceleration bands happen, then you would get out if it closes below that bar's low. So let's show you an example here. This is Research in Motion, now BBRY, actually, the maker of the BlackBerry. And, of course, before Apple ate their lunch, along with Google, with the Android devices, we know that RIM was a wonderful leader in the whole mobile market initially, and this is why it always pays to be proactive here. We're going to talk about percent R in a minute. This is the original percent R scale, 0 to minus 100. I use a little different scale that I'll share with you. But look, this is where we're breaking outside of those acceleration bands in green, and the blue Bollinger Band is racing faster outside of there. So generally speaking, and I know Mr. Bollinger would talk about the squeeze and how things start to break out. And this would be this kind of volatility expansion principle. You're looking for catching a move as volatility just starts to expand off of that squeeze area. So it's just starting to go from a volatility contraction, or where people are starting to get kind of lulled to sleep, into a situation in which we're really looking for where do people start to get interested again? So from this perspective, what we would look at is say, okay, you see how the Bollinger contracts back into the acceleration band there, but it does not close below that bar's low. So we use that kind of retracement. There's another one. The Bollinger starts to contract a little bit inside the acceleration, but it doesn't close below those lows. This would be obviously a little bit of a longer-term indicator on a daily chart, although you could use it on an hourly chart and take it down to about a multi-week indicator rather than a multi-month indicator, okay, on your hourlies. But notice, once it actually crosses and then violates underneath there, you're saying, look, now we're back into the trading range. When the Bollingers are trapped inside of the accelerations, it's not of interest to me. That's a dead zone period. You see, you would miss this phase of the market here where things are just chop, chop, chop. You would stay away from all that noise. You don't want to be buying options through a trading range scenario. Those of you that like to do option spreads might be more interested in doing credit spreads or other kinds of option selling strategies with limited risk. Never sell an option naked, in my view, when you can do a credit spread instead, but that's for another time. But you see, what's interesting about this next signal here is it just starts to break out one and two closes outside of there on this one in April, and initially, look at how it has an initial little pullback on that initial drop right there. Now, we're not getting an exit unless when this cross happened right there, if that low had been taken out, didn't happen. This next cross, it did get taken out, and you did get knocked out And then, of course, it gaps on earnings. So then you get another gap. You're getting a buy signal there, and it's catching it as you trail it on up, next stop there. So not as much profit in that last signal as the prior two, but pretty nice way to catch the trend phase rather than the and avoid the trading range phase. This is the old Lehman Brothers, of course, now belly up, going back and looking at, you know, again, you got a couple of you got a whip on the upside. Again, it was below a longer-term trend line, though, so we didn't take that signal. But then look at what's happening. See how it's trying to go one bar below there, but then the second bar is back above, so you would not take that first signal there. The next signal that happens, well, you can see one and then one back above, so there's one and then there's two outside of the band right there. Okay, so at that point, you're setting it up for a potential catch a move to the downside from the mid 63 range down into the mid 50s to low 50s. Now, the beauty of this too is that when you use the closing stops, you will not get whipped out by one of those fake outs to the upside that then shoots back down. You're still on the downtrend here. So you should be booking half of your profit if you can get a double and an options buy. And then if you get one of these little violent periods here, it still keeps you on it because look at where the cross happened. The cross of the Bollinger back inside of the acceleration happened right there, and it just ever so slightly violated right there. So you're back in a trading range mode. In a trading range, you'll notice the Bollingers are probably going to get tagged before the acceleration bands. You can see the support and the resistance of the Bollingers, even though it moved up into the acceleration band there, but notice we did not get a new signal because the Bollingers didn't catch up with the accelerations fast enough. Okay, so that's a way you can integrate the two indicators together if you like. It certainly can help you see volatility expansion compared to volatility contraction. I got to keep it moving because I got a lot more I want to share with you. Williams percent R, the percent range indicator developed by Larry Williams, is like a stochastic or an RSI. It's looking for overbought and oversold levels. Now, I'll give you a little taste here. Most are using a 10 or a 14 bar setting. My testing says for the way I like to use it as turning it into a trend indicator, I'm actually looking at the last 30 periods of action. So a daily, it's the last 30 days. An hourly, it's about the last 4 days, the last 30 hourly bars. So that it's going to smooth out some of that normal whip that the percent R will show you and still allow you to trade this kind of unusual pattern here. Now, this is something where you know that when you hear the word overbought, you've been trained to assume that overbought is, quote, bad. Overbought means it's got to come down, right? But you know what? On the positive scale, 0 to 100% that I like to use for the thing about, like, if I tell you, what does that mean? It means that, say you got a stock trading between 100 and 110, and I tell you the stock's at 108, well, that would be the 80th percentile, right? On a 10-point range, it's at the 80th percentile up at 108 within a 100 to 110 range. That's at 80%. If it moves above 80%, and then guess what? If the stock keeps going up, and my definition of that is if it closes above that bar's high, that's actually a bullish confirmation that it's going out of the range and into more of a likely trend phase. Okay, and these don't always work, but when they work, they're really powerful on the way up, and when they don't work, you get out real quickly and you move on to the next one. Okay, bear trends, it's just the opposite. Again, this is so counterintuitive. Everything you've been told is oversold means it's about washed out. Not so much if it keeps going down after initially going in that bottom 20% of readings. So if it closes below that first oversold bar's low, that's a breakdown, folks. That's where institutions are bailing. My belief as to why this works is because institutions, we all know, are the ones driving the train for, you know, stock prices, market prices. And the bottom line is that our job as individual traders, whether you're trading $10,000 or $10 million, we're all still small fish in that big pond. We need to go ahead and make sure we're taking advantage of that potential breakout. Now, this uses the old Williams scale, 0 to minus 100%. So you can see overbought for the old Williams scale would be at the minus 20 level. So if you're using that at home, keep that in mind. It's just the numbers change. The line doesn't actually change. The first time it went overbought here did not close above that high, so you'd turn it back off. And then the next time it went, it gapped up, and so the next time it went above that overbought area here, it's happening the day of the earnings gap up, and you see what happens. The next day it closes above there. So that's the what I call the bull confirmation. Now, how many times have you been on the outside looking in and wishing you could participate in a move, but you think it's moved too far too fast? Well, in a normal retracement, we actually like to see it come back and test just under that overbought threshold, and that forms what we call the retest. That low should not be closed below. It can trade below there in a future day, but don't let it close below there. If it closes below there, you got to say bye-bye. So the first move on the retest, you catch it. It has a nice little run. This was MasterCard. And then you see the next one. I say, look, if you miss that first move, look, the next time it tests underneath that overbought threshold, we were in there buying into that dip and buying calls, betting it was going to turn and flip. If we're wrong, we get stopped out quickly. We don't hold on to the position too long. If we're right, we can really catch it and then really see it flip and turn to the upside, okay? And then eventually you're going to be wrong. People always, the biggest question I get on this big trends way to trade percent R is, how do you know you're going to be right? And my answer is, I don't. Okay, and you say, well, that doesn't breed any confidence. Well, the reality is we're trading a probability game of saying when we're wrong, we're going to be wrong smaller than when we're right, we've got the potential to be right bigger. Okay, so you see these next couple of retests, the first one there, it really doesn't get a whole lot of lift, and then the next one, it's going to violate ever so slightly, but it's going to close underneath there. So you see that at that point, if you're buying those retest points, you're not going to make any money. You're probably going to lose a little bit buying an option, but my whole contention is lose small, win big. That's really the secret of the game. So we're talking about trades on this one that went up 100 and then 200% into these moves just a week later versus quick 20% or less type of stop outs, buying the retest. If you buy the breakout, you might have to endure a retest. And you see the next time it broke out here when it was going overbought, it didn't get through that resistance and you stayed away from that trade. Okay, so that one saved you by waiting for the confirmation. Prior example with GLD, went in a better time for gold on the way up. It's been more bearish on the latest GLDs, but you can see. Sometimes percent R will give you a signal. This is where you want to lay these indicators together. Let me talk about the one that didn't work first. You see percent R going overbought and then starting to break out here, but notice what's not happening here. It's not getting through the upper acceleration band in blue. So compare that to the other two signals that worked really well on the upside, and you can see that actually there's your breakout outside the bands and then the second close outside the acceleration bands plus the percent R keeps you on board a powerful trend. It keeps testing into that band. This acceleration band is a little slower to catch up. You can see, yes, it violates by that point, and then notice as it tries to go overbought again right into the upper band, you don't get a confirmation. It actually turns and flips back down. It saves you from a fake out potential trade, even though it looks like it's starting to get going to the upside again there in early September. No thank you. And you see even over on the left side, there's your breakout. And then here's what we call the retest. Again, you got in the breakout. Even though it's coming back into the band, this low on the left side of the page is your low-risk entry retest, and you see it's catching the next lift point. Of course, the final retest when it violates, you say, nope, didn't hold the next bar. I'm done with that trade. Then it's chop city for a while. And then you see on the downside how it catches. So it just is breaking down on this first low. Big shot down there. You can see this one got a little bit of extension the next day or so, but really didn't get a whole lot of lift and then kind of flattened out by the time the retest gave a violation. We'd be looking for a way out of the trade after that point. You see that one's exiting a couple weeks later, 2.5 weeks later. Now, how do you convert these stock and ETF ideas and whatever vehicle you like to trade into an option trade? My contention is I would much rather trade an in-the-money option than an out-of-the-money or at-the-money option if I'm buying. You know, if I'm selling, I tend to sell out-of-the-money. Credit spreads is a way to do that. But simple strategy here is buy the in-the-money option. You know, I often think back to, you know, we're all familiar with the movie Wall Street and Gordon DeGecko's quote, greed is good. Well, you know what? Greed is not good when it comes to how you choose your option strike prices. I would much rather have you assume less than the best, assume that potentially what happens if it doesn't move? How do I limit my risk if it's not moving as fast as I want, if I get on one of those fake out trades? And the in-the-money option gives you a way to contain more of the time value risk and put more of the focus on the intrinsic value. I call this a stock substitute approach because you're basically trading the in-the-money a lot more like the stock. If you were bearish on XYZ, say the stock's at 56.60, you get a bearish signal. A lot of people buy the 55 put, trying to say you think it's going to 50. They think, oh, that 55 put's a home run if it gets to 50. And if it does, that's true. But if it doesn't, you're buying all-time risk in the 55. By buying the 60 put, when the stock's at 56.60, you know what that differential means. A put means it's a right to sell the stock at 60. It's already down at 56.6, so it's worth 3.40 intrinsically. You're paying that extra $1.30 on top of that, $4.70 total, that extra $1.30 of that is time value. That means if it doesn't move at all, stays at 56.60 at the expiration, then you're looking at about a 28% loss of time. But it's not 100% loss of time. So right away, you're keeping your risk factor down by a factor of 3.5. almost 4-to-1. So that helps. If it does go to 50, then you see in this example, you're saying, look, the short shares gain just about 12%, 11.7. But the in-the-money option, what's that worth? If at 50 on a 60-strike put, that put by definition is worth 10 points or 1,000 bucks for one contract controlling 100 shares, which is the norm. Then basically say, look, before commissions, which is what these examples are, before commissions, you're looking at a gross profit of 112% or more than 9 times, almost 10 times, but more than 9 times leverage effect of the in-the-money option compared to the stock. You don't need to be trading 20, 30, 50-to-1 leverage. You know, in fact, ask those Forex folks when that Swiss franc gap down, even those Forex brokers got left holding the bag on some really overly dramatic leverage against them. You know, so, you know, for example, on the downside, I think it's fascinating. This is a chart from Bear Stearns, just using the old Williams 0 to minus underscale. BSE was a symbol. And there's so many fake outs on this chart, and it shows you how you could have saved yourself a ton of fake outs and then get on the true breakout. When it goes oversold in the bottom 20% of readings, if it does not close under there, you don't take the trade. If it comes back above there, you just turn it off. So at that point, you're literally saying, I'm not following this thing anymore. I'm waiting for the next, what I call, setup. Look at the next one. Right off of that, it goes oversold again. Off of that point, doesn't close below there, turn it off again. You're not taking these little fake out trades as it comes oversold. Oversold, in this case, is the bottom of the range for these points. But guess what? I'm not trying to buy into that. That would be costly as well. You can see that one gets turned off here a couple days later. Then it goes oversold again. So we've had 5 different fakeouts, now 6 actually on this chart, that have never confirmed. You and I know that if you were trying to trade Bear Stearns on the downside through that, there's no way you would be around to take that 7th signal when it actually does break down and confirm, right? So here's the 7th setup on the blue line here. 2 days later, it breaks below there while staying oversold. That's the bearish confirmation, the first leg down. From a money management perspective, I tend to tell my students, look, put half of your capital in on the breakdown and then half on the retest, okay? And again, I've got to keep it moving here because I'm behind on my slides, a lot to share with you. There's your retest, and I see it happen so much of the time. The next morning, we bought a put into that retest. It opened against us the next morning up, but we don't get overreactive to that. We say it's got to close through there to get us out. It tanks from 130 down to 100 and then gives the next retest and then violates right there. And that blue arrow is just an exit. It's not a buy. It's just an exit of your short. Okay, so as I said before, take half of your trade off when you hit a double on an option. That gets you all your risk capital back. You release the fear that we all have of giving back profits. It allows you to ride the other half position until it either gives back half of its peak gain or exit half again if it doubles on top of a double. Here's the rest of the Bear Stearns story. This is with the percent R signals. You can see, though, with the acceleration bands on top of it, a little sweet spot right there. Didn't do a whole lot by the time it exited on the first one, but then the second one was an absolute home run as it breaks down. Percent R is giving the sell there. The acceleration bands are coming on board a couple bars later. The stock's going from the 60s down to a few dollars. It ends up going back to 10 as J.P. Morgan has to revise their buyout offer from $2 to $10 a share. But bottom line is, and oh, by the way, there's a near percent R retest right there as well on that little bounce back, that slight little upturn there. So bottom line is, don't try to catch a falling knife. They can be very powerful on the downside. Quick little primer on the concept of efficiency. You know, I ask a lot of people this question. Let's say you had a stock that was at, we're going to take two stocks, and say both of them start at $50. A stock in red is, say, your typical tech stock. Stock in white, say, a utility stock. But both of them are going from 50 to 60 over the same period of time. Say, you know, it takes 2 months to have them go there. What, in which of these would you rather buy, say, a 3-month call, a 50 call at the money? The red tech stock that's more volatile, and say it's 2 times as volatile, twice the implied volatility as in red, as the white stock. You know, most of the people that tell me red say, well, I'd like to trade that more volatile stock because it's got twice the chance to move. I can potentially trade the zigs and the zags. Those that say the white stock say, well, I like that it's smoother and steadier. From an options perspective only, if you're paying twice as much for the same move in red, you're only going to get half the ROI in red. So actually, white is the one that you want to be in from the ride from the beginning to the end, from 50 to 60. if you trade the white options, you buy them for half as much volatility as red, you're going to get twice the return on your investment. And oh, by the way, if you use a trailing stop, what's going to happen on your trailing stop? If you're in red, you may well get whipsawed out at the worst possible time on red, right? So that basically, we're looking for these very efficient, steady movers rather than the volatile movers, you know, because you pay for that volatility in options. So with efficiency ratio, this is that Perry Kaufman idea that I just converted into an indicator. You see, when it gets over its overbought threshold here, it's already a buy signal on percent R, but efficiency is coming in a day later. So sometimes these are not all happening on the same day, but this can be a way you can scale into a trade and then add to it as you get more and more confidence. Notice efficiency comes in for what we call a retest right here off of that low. This is on silver, SLV. You're getting several of those retests along the way here. So if you missed any of these waves on the way up, you can place yet another trade into the retest points, and that's how you can stay with the trend. Now, obviously, eventually that trend's got to end, but this is getting to some really insane positive efficiency at plus 80. Plus 100 is as high as it can actually go. That would be with no retracements along the way. Obviously, everything has a retracement. You can see right off the dotted line, those retests are going to get violated there, and that's when they started to tighten the margin requirements and, of course, kind of burst the silver bubble. But you can see here, too, we get another little window on the way up later that's not quite as powerful. You can see that window only lasted for a brief time on efficiency, and it edged up, but not very much. Okay, so some of those that don't work, they kind of fizzle out, but you don't worry too much about it. This is the S&P dropping during the debt crisis, the summer of 11. You can see that we're starting to drop below that support, and then you're catching a quick pop on the downside over the next few days here. Okay, so the goal here is that you're trying to just cash that first leg, and then of course you come in for a retest, and then you've got a pretty volatile market there, but if you missed it, could also be putting it on the retest, catching another piece of that. And then it goes back into the chop zone after it violates, and you say, okay, chop city, let's stay away from that trading range type of a situation. First Solar, another one where you see it gets that initial breakout, follows through above there, and then even as it comes, this is the percent R, but then when the retest happened, the efficiency really didn't officially get confirmed until this third chance. The first two chances, it did not follow through. So percent R was a little bit earlier. But notice, coming off of that area right there, where did it break out? Just a few bars later, and where does it catch that big acceleration through that phase right there? So then when the retest happens on it, okay, then of course you're getting a violation. Then it's chop city for a couple of months. And then again, starts to break out on efficiency again, and the stock absolutely takes off with multiple retest points keeping you in the game right before a next big gap up. Came down hard after the gap up. Notice it's right off that low. It stays with it all the way until this violation of the last one right there, and then you're done with the trade. So it does a good job of telling you when you're on a steady trend and when to stay away. On the downside, American Home, one of these mortgage providers that was doing the subprime loans, you can see this last one in particular, on efficiency, you can see it was saying we're setting up here for a breakdown right off of the gap. So once you fall through under that gap, watch out below. The close below there was Katie barred the door. The stock went from 15 to nothing over the next month and a half. Okay, so that's what we're looking for. So we start layering these indicators on top of each other, and we start saying this is AIG. You know, AIG, nobody could believe that the big insurance company was that vulnerable. But you can see it caught the first leg down there in the basically the late spring to summer of 08. And then the next one, of course, it caught as we were just starting to shoot down there. You can see. And again, there's one where it didn't work. So you got two that were right, one that was wrong. You know, even if you're trading 50-50 and there was a wrong one on percent R alone, although the bands were not broken on the upside there. So even if we're two out of four, the nature of this would be quick losers on the two that didn't work and catching very big moves on the two that did, right? So that's really the nature of the game. That's what you're after. And, of course, we're talking about efficiency being in this bottom tier zone. So when you catch those windows of efficiency there, you can see just how good of a time it is to be on board the stock. And so, again, that's where we're starting to go efficient on the downside. And that last move is AIG collapse and then the government bailout happened to try to back those up. So you start layering in, you know, acceleration principles. You know, you see there's the breakout on the acceleration. There's a breakout on the percent R. Notice efficiency on this one came in a little bit later. So maybe you got a partial position before that surge up, and then the efficiency tells you you can get another piece as it breaks out a couple of days after the gap up, you get another window up, and that's what we're after. Catch the window up, get part of your profit booked, and trail the stop to break even or higher on the rest, okay? We teach a lot about those money management principles through our Big Trends training. But, you know, bottom line, there's a Netflix on the downside. Netflix has been all over the place in both directions. It's had its windows up and its windows down. And you see on this last one on the way down, it was just starting to collapse. And that's where a lot of people assume, well, it's gapping down. You hear the old trading motto, all gaps eventually get filled. I think it's a mistake, especially in short-term trading and trend trading, to assume that, because this one, of course, it broke the acceleration band, then it confirmed, and percent R was already there, of course, before those. So percent R will tend to lead, but then the other ones will confirm, and you can still get meaningful pieces of the trend there. There's a prior one on Agrium also on the way down. You can see, you know, it's catching efficiencies coming in a little bit after that, so it's only catching part of that move. So you've got to really consider getting part of your move on, part of your capital on when you're seeing that first breakout, and then adding to it as you get these other confirmations along the way. Rand Gold Resources, GOLD is the symbol of the stock, was one that I was talking to people about back as early as 2008. This is a company that actually sold out actual mining interest and converted that money into buying royalty interest on other mines. So it became, the stock itself became like an option. And you can see how this pattern works here. Percent R gives you the signal first, because it breaks out overbought and then breaks through there. Notice the acceleration bands come on a little bit later, a couple bars later, you see on the acceleration band there, and notice efficiency coming on just right after that. So now all three of them are lined up together as we then start the big surge from mid-July into mid-August. So that's a one-month move, and of course you see how strongly efficient it's moving. What does efficiency essentially mean? It means that you're moving up a lot in this case, and when you do have givebacks, they're essentially very shallow pullbacks. They're not sharp, jagged drops. It's essentially more of a stair-step pattern, kind of like an escalator, right? That's what you're after when you're talking about the very efficient trends. You don't want to trade something that's doing one of these. You know, if you're doing one of those, then basically we say stay away from that. That's going to give you a lot of volatility and no real directional edge. So put an X through that and look for those stair steps. That's what you're after, stair steps up or down. So if it does flatten out, you buy the in the money option, you're not really getting hurt by that. You're just waiting it out, ready for the next move to the upside. Now, from a time frame perspective, I know we got all kinds of traders in with us today. The percent R signals, for example, tend to last between 20 and 30 bars or candles of action, okay? So what we're looking at is if you're a day trader, I don't like one-minute charts. I find that noise is my enemy as a trend trader. Even five-minute charts for me are a little noisy. I find that I get greater success looking at a 15-minute chart and just waiting for each 15-minute bar's close. It allows you also to step away for a few minutes if you need to, because you're really looking at close-to-close action and not trying to overreact or essentially screen watch all day. I'd rather say, look, it takes your stress level down and still allows you to catch a move in and out in the same day. We just did that a couple of days ago on Baidu for a big score for our weekly options folks. You know, so the bottom line is that, you know, we're looking for those opportunities. Now, if you swing trade over usually up to a week, I would say focus on the hourly, because, again, 7 hours in each trading day. We don't look at after-hour stuff. We're just looking at the core most active period, 9:30 to 4 p.m. Eastern. And so we're saying, look, let's focus on that. And so the hourly is your core chart. But you still want to be aware of these other time frames. The more you sync up the multiple time frames, the better off you are. Usually about a one-month hold for a position trader, like we said before, it would be about 4 to 6 weeks on a daily chart with the percent R. So that, and if you're buying an option, you want to make sure typically you buy more time than you need. So if you expect to be in it for a month, you might go ahead and buy 2 months out. And, of course, now if you expect to be in it for a week, you could buy 2 weeks out with weekly options on a lot of the big stocks. If you're more of an intermediate-term investor, active investor, I might call this next category, you might consider using weekly charts. And then even if you're a longer-term, which you consider you don't make a lot of changes, a monthly chart would look out typically over a couple years or so. So from that perspective, you know, you can still use the monthlies if you're a longer-term investor slash proactive type that still wants to evaluate this stuff. Now, you know, if I'm looking at it saying, okay, you know, how can you learn more of these lessons? Obviously, in 45 or 50 minutes, there's only so much that we can cover trying to pack 25 years worth of knowledge into, you know, a window to get you some exposure to what you might be missing. You know, and so what I did as a way to say thank you for being with us in today's session, give you some really lifetime training that you can basically review as many times as you want the rest of your life on acceleration bands. This course, I basically said, look, usually I wouldn't take it down any less than $99. Today I'm offering it to you for just $49. This is 4+ hours of content with me teaching you about acceleration bands. Little special secrets and tips, of course, the core elements of the system, how to get in, how to get out, but all the little things you want to look for during a trade. You know, it's easy to get in. For a lot of people, it's harder to get out. This system is very clear about telling you when you stay with the trend and when you hop out. But then it's also looking for not just if you trade stocks and not just if you trade options. It's looking for something for all types of traders. You can see we've actually got 6 different modules and sessions that I created. And each one goes a half hour plus. It adds up to more like probably averaging 45 minutes apiece because it's 4+ hours. But the bottom line is we'll give you the basic rules on the acceleration bands, then how to apply it to stocks and ETFs. If you're a more active futures trader or if you're a Forex trader, there's a session for each of those in addition to then how to find option strategies and in particular looking at option charts, which is a new concept for a lot of people. And then the special tips and tricks and secrets that you want to make sure you add in to know exactly how you can better manage your positions, whether you're trading any of these different vehicles using acceleration bands. We give you the formula. We give you all the details about how to use it and how you can plot it. And basically, of course, it's available on MetaStock as part of the toolkit. Now, that link we set up for you, maybe Kelly can post it here for me because I can't. It's bigtrends.com/accelerationbands right there on the bottom. So you just type it all in as one full word within the link, bigtrends.com/accelerationbands. And when you go to that, it's a very limited time offer because this is already too low. Yeah, if you can put the www in front of that, Kelly, I appreciate it. I forgot to mention you got to add that within the Citrix platform here for GoToWebinar for it to link up. www.bigtrends.com/accelerationbands. Does ADX help in this example comes a question. You can certainly use ADX. I use ADX all the time. And in fact, you know, ADX is a nice confirmation tool that you are in a trending phase. So that's a part of what we teach is the DMI lines and what we call the DMI difference, which is another uniqueness in the toolkit. So remember that link. That this is how you can take advantage of this today for the all-time low price of just $49. And thanks for reposting that. I hope that's linkable. It doesn't look like it on mine, but you can also plot it. Just make a note of it. Write it down, folks. bigtrends.com/accelerationbands and go to it once you're done with the training today. I think you'll find you'll really enjoy that 4+ hours and you get a dedicated email where you can ask questions so we don't leave you hanging. You can always ask questions so you understand exactly every aspect of those 4 hours of training. You can watch them in bite-sized pieces that way too. Okay, now I want to remind you though about the toolkit for MetaStock because this is powerful stuff. I mean, I didn't even really get a chance to show you the other big thing that I love about MetaStock, and that is scanning. You can take any one of these indicators. You can say, okay, show me acceleration bands, breakouts to the upside or the downside at today's close. You know, we had a pretty wicked sell-off there yesterday in the markets, post-jobs report. And, you know, the idea here is that you really want to position yourself to take advantage of what's next. You know, it's looking backwards is all well and good, but now everybody wants to know what about where we're going now. With each of these indicators, you can run scans across all the optionable stocks, the 4,000-plus optionable stocks in the optionable database, or you can tighten it up to all S&P 500 stocks, all NASDAQ 100 stocks. Pick your sector. One of the great things about MetaStock, they have some of the best data in the world. We're talking about incredible access, and this doesn't just apply to the U.S. They've got incredible access to worldwide data too. You can use this on any particular market you want to trade, and so it's powerful stuff. You run the scans, and it gives me it takes all those thousands of ideas, and it literally gives me just a handful that I can focus on at a time here. So techniques like I share with you, the efficiency ratio, a lot of things I didn't have time to share. Somebody asked about ADX. This is the combination of the DMI and ADX along with what we call the DMI difference, finding those really super strong breakouts. percent above the moving averages, that's another great one to give you relative strength. And we even have a market timing indicator called the NASDAQ relative strength against the S&P. It shows you where the money flow is going for the institutions. Percent R trends, looking at divergences as well in momentum and MACD. A lot of great stuff on there, a tweak on stochastics, a tweak on Elder's Force Index. You know, lots of things that are there for you to explore. I always say start with percent R and acceleration bands. Those two together are a great combination. And then you start adding tools like efficiency ratio and all the others, and I think you'll find it'll just keep on helping you filter to the best of the best. And so there's actually 14 different indicators. There's a lot of those systematized and then scan ability to be able to pick up the newest signals. I'm going to go ahead and hand it back over to Kelly so he can kind of remind you how you can take advantage of the Big Trends Toolkit. I want to thank you for being with me today, and stay with us because there's a whole lot more great education to come today, and I know you're going to have a ton of different ideas by the time it's all done. But do remember that bigtrends.com/accelerationman special to get that at a $49 all-time low price point to continue your education. You can watch it at your own pace as many times as you like. And thanks so much to Kelly and the rest of the MetaStock group for being with us today. And I know you're going to want to stay tuned for Chuck Hughes' presentation next. Back over to you, Kelly.
Thank you, Price. I appreciate that. You know, as I mentioned at the beginning of the presentation, Price is definitely a very robust speaker. I mean, he really gets the points across well, and you're really able to pull a lot out of his presentations. I can see from the comments that people are giving that, you know, definitely Price's methodologies resound with people, and that's what we found over the years, and that's why Price's Big Trends Toolkit is one of the top sellers for MetaStock. So let's just show you a little bit more about what's in the Big Trends Toolkit. Obviously, again, as Price said, 13 different indicators, 15 different expert advisors, 15 explorations, and 15 system tests. And what's great about Price's system is it's all open source. So you can go in, you can see what how he's put it together, what he's done, what he's given you, modify it to fit everything that you want to do, the acceleration bands. And of course, somebody was just asking, does this course include efficiency in Williams? That's more maybe a question for Price, but the Big Trends Toolkit definitely does. And let's just go through it here. So here's all the different indicators in there that Price just showed you, so I'm not going to spend a lot of time there. Here's all the different systems that are built into it. So these both have a scan and a back test that you can go through. The normal price for the Big Trends Toolkit is $499. Here at the Summit, we offer it for $449. Again, you can call any of our sales guys here at 1-800-882-3040 or visit us at metastock.com/saleschat, and they can chat with you while you're watching the next parts of the summit as well. So feel free to contact our team either way, metastock.com/saleschat or the phone number there. Again, if you take advantage of the Big Trends Toolkit or any of the other plugins, you'll get the free copy of Task already, but you'll also get 2 whole years of Task through our sponsor, Stocks and Commodities, who we thank for putting this together. The Summit Action Pack, if you're looking at getting the whole package together from all of our presenters and really being able to pull together all their ideas, normally this is about $2,700 retail value. We're giving it today for $1,595, which is it's a $1,200 savings for you to be able to get all this. And again, all this comes on a 30-day money-back guarantee, so you can try out any of these methods and see how they work for you on them. That money-back guarantee. So you can see these, you get the 2 free months of MetaStock, you get the Barry Burns, the Chuck Hughes, the Price Headley, the John Bollinger, and the Steve Bigelow profit system for all that. And again, if you already have these, give us a call. We can talk to you about individual deals on them if you just have already have some of the add-ons. Reader's Choice Award for MetaStock. We've won this for the last 25 years in a row. We're very, very proud of this. So, you know, it's definitely a good reason to try out MetaStock and get a good feel for what MetaStock does.